we've done so far is we've performed the forward and backward error analysis of the dot product. And we came up with these different results. Two backward error results and one forward error result. The backward error results throw the error back at the vectors that are the inputs, and the forward result throws the error onto the resulting scalar that's computed, kappa. So what we want to show you now is how you can take such results and use them to come up with backward error results for more complex operations. So what's the next more complex operation that we might run into? A matrix vector multiply. Now, this y is obviously different than this y because here we're using it in a dot product and here it's the result of a matrix vector multiply, but by now you should be used to that. So if we just write this in terms of the dot products that can be performed to compute the matrix vector multiply, what we get is the following. Psi 0 through psi m minus 1 is equal to, let's see, A0 tilde transpose, that's the first row of matrix A, through AM minus 1 tilde transpose. And that multiplies vector X. And then what we get are the dot products of the rows with the vector X. All right. And what you now notice is, hey, all we're doing here is a bunch of dot products. And therefore, we may be able to use one of the error results that we have for computing dot products to analyze this. All right? Now, what we notice then is that the computed entries in Y are equal to, let's see, for each of these dot products, what we can do is add a perturbed row to each of the rows when doing the dot product. Okay, so this particular result of a dot product is just the result of the slightly changed vector, row vector A0, to which we now have to add a small change, which is a vector, and we multiply that times the vector x. Now obviously what we can do is we can make it even more explicit by taking these transposes and putting them right there. Okay, and that makes it easier to see what the corresponding results over here are. And we do that for every row. And it's not hard to see that you can massage all of that into, let's see, the computed vector y check, is equal to A plus some changed matrix A. In previous videos, I used a lower delta. In the notes, we use an uppercase delta here to indicate the changed matrix. Times vector x, where the rows in this particular matrix are just these vectors right here viewed as row vectors. Okay, if we now look at our matrix delta A, that's just the matrix of the row vectors delta A0 tilde transpose through delta AM minus 1 tilde transpose. And if we take the element-wise absolute value of that, that's the same as the element-wise absolute value of each of the rows. But you can also think of that as the absolute value of the column vector that became that row and then transposed. So we can write it like that. Okay, now, each of these rows right here, or rather the columns that became rows, is bounded by gamma n times the appropriate row that it's added to. So this here is less than or equal to gamma n times the absolute value of a zero transposed through gamma n times a m minus 1 tilde transposed. And that then we can, yeah, we can factor out the gamma n. It's a scalar, so we can say that's equal to gamma n times, and if you think about it, this is just the absolute value of matrix A. So what we conclude is that the computed y is equal to the result of a matrix vector multiplied with a slightly perturbed matrix A, where we can put a bound on that matrix, that perturbation, that delta A, in terms of the matrix A to which it's a perturbation. And bingo, we have a backward error result. Now, in the homework, we're going to make you think about, just like here, we threw the error onto x, we threw the error onto y. I wonder if we can take all of our error and throw it onto x so that it's a times x plus some delta x. And we're going to make you think about that a little bit.